Hello, dear friends. Welcome to ZenPod once again. Gives me great pleasure to welcome Dr. Janki Santokh to our studios. Dr. Janki Santokh is a PhD in philosophy, a lecturer, author, corporate resource professional, and a public speaker. Dr. Janki studied Vedanta, a full-time three-year residential program at Swami Parthasarathi's Vedanta Academy. For the past 30 years, Dr. Janki has been full-time into research and propagation of Vedanta. Her service to society in the field of Vedanta has taken the following forms: delivering weekly lectures on Vedanta and Gita, author of the book How Do You Know What You Know, urging us to think because our lives depend on it. She gives public lectures and webinars on practical Vedantic topics. Dr. Janki has a YouTube channel, and her team and she have dished out over 150 videos, which is watched worldwide. She contributes to articles in prominent newspapers like the Times of India, On the Speaking Tree, and Dainik Bhaskar. She runs management training programs for companies such as the Indian Oil Corporation, Gillette, GlaxoSmithKline, Bharat Petroleum, the Young Presidents Organization, among others. Janki Ji's logical and engaging sessions in Vedanta and Gita bring home the relevance of the ancient words to today's world. Her approachable style encourages questions and discussions, and you will realize by the end of this podcast how she leaves you with more questions and urges you to think on why we lead the life that we do. So it gives me great pleasure in welcoming Janki once more to ZenPod. Welcome, Janki Ji. Hello, friends. Welcome to ZenPod once again. I have somebody who's spiritually uplifted already, unlike a lot of us, and we're going to talk about interesting subjects like Vedanta and really the right way of leading life, her method of leading a fulfilling life. And Janki, welcome to the show. It's a pleasure having you, and really appreciate you taking time from your busy schedule.
Thank you. My pleasure.
How do you define spirituality?
Spirituality is defined actually in Vedanta itself. I don't need to come up with a new one, or even English. If we see the word religion, religion comes from two Latin words, religare.
Okay.
Ligare means to join, and re means again. So to join again. So what are we to join again to? Obviously something that we have separated from.
Okay.
So what is that thing we have separated from? It is our own self. So our journey to rediscover our own self, our divine pure self, is what religion is all about, divested of its dogmatic outgrowths, of course. So religion, spirituality is all about reaching back to your own divine self. The Sanskrit word yoga comes from the word union, yuj, to join again. So it's all telling us that we have to join, to get back to something, we have to rejoin with our divine self.
Wow. Beautiful. Beautiful. In your opinion, Janki Ji, how can spirituality be tapped into for day-to-day living?
Well, I think this is actually putting the cart before the horse, in the sense that spirituality is what is the, it is what we use for our day-to-day living.
Okay.
There is no spirituality other than that.
Okay.
When you divorce spirituality or religion or anything divine from your daily life, that's when the problems start.
Okay.
So living life properly, correctly, I don't mean by some moral rules, but living it properly is the path towards finding your own self. You have to just learn the art of living it properly. Living it properly means you live a happy life, a contented life, a progressive life. You don't go by past conditionings. You apply yourself each time to the situation in front of you. You work for the welfare of all. You know, everything is... Religion basically gives you tools to help you live your daily life. And when it doesn't do that, that's when we become agitated, we become self-centered, we generate chaos and mess. know, like that manja that gets, you know, in a flying a kite, that manja that gets all, it, life becomes like that.
That's a nice
when
comment.
It is not led by that kite into something higher in life.
Very nice analogy. Your tryst with Vedanta and your journey, can you please let us in on it?
I joined Swamiji full-time, Swami Parthasarathy, his Vedanta Academy, and with him ever since, of course, in 1988, like over 30 years ago. I was just stepped out of graduation, given my graduation exams, and then I went and joined the Academy. I was, I was very convinced from my teenage years, I was very convinced that this doesn't seem right, you know, like everybody told me, like, okay, as a teenager, I was confused, like all teenagers are confused.
Right.
I had lots of questions and all. And all the elders would tell me, this is all your teenage years. And then when you grow up, you won't have all these kind of things. So then I used to look at the grown-ups, like 40-year-olds and all. For me, 40-year-old was like a very, very old person. So I would look at them and I would say, he's got to 40, but doesn't look like he's got anything. He still looks pretty confused to me. He doesn't know anything. And I look around and I say, no, this is not right. That, you know, you finish your graduation and you do your post-grad, and from a very educated family. So doing post-grad, you know, being very educated was like the done thing. And then you take up a job or a profession. My father was a barrister, so, you know, I could have just joined his legal practice. And he said, no, this is not sounding right. Then you just take some work, you earn some money, you get married, you have children. This cannot be correct. This, I mean, nothing wrong in this per se, but this is not the full answer. So then I was hunting everywhere. I was like wondering. I read, I was very fond of Somerset Maugham at that time. So Razor's Edge. Razor's Edge was a big influence on me. And I wanted to be like him and go to Rishikesh and find out what is there, what is this thing. But my parents thought that was a rather daft thing for a 14-year-old to be doing. So that plan died. And then one day, my mother took me to Swamiji's lecture, and then I heard him, and it was nice. He cracks a lot of jokes, and he was funny, and so I liked him. And then one day I was chatting with her, and I said, okay, what about this and what about that? I was asking her questions. She said, look, I don't know. Oh, I find whoever knows and ask him. She was just fed up with my questioning. So since we had gone to the lecture, an invite had come for another one. So I said, you know, this guy claims to know, I will ask him. So I picked up the phone and I called him.
Oh my God, really?
Really? He's like, he claims to know, right? So I'll ask him. So then I picked up, I called him. So I said, may I speak to Swamiji? He said, speaking.
Speaking? God.
I never thought that he's going to pick up his own phone. I mean, like, nobody does that, right?
Yeah.
So I said, now I was completely like, you know, so I said, I didn't know what to say. So I said, may I come and see you? And he said, yeah, sure. Come tomorrow.
Oh.
I said, this is like really odd, you know.
Yeah.
He's like a big guy. He's famous. He's like, you know, he's have these 1,000 people listening to him. I'm just a college kid. What's he doing? You know, I was too flabbergasted to know what to do with this. So I said, okay. And we fixed the time for 9:30 tomorrow morning.
Okay.
And so then I went there. So, and then he said, you want to join the academy? I said, no, I don't join any academy. I just have a few questions for you.
Okay.
But by next Monday, I joined the academy.
Oh my God.
It was pretty quick.
Wow.
So it was like, I wanted to know. I really wanted to know, why is all this? What's going on here? And he seemed the only person to me who was giving any kind of reasonable answer. Everybody else was dodging the question or finding the question silly or just, you know, like saying, forget it, you know, or something like that. He answered every question I had.
Wow.
And I couldn't believe it. And I really couldn't believe that he picks up his own phone. In fact, even till today, he's like 92. And he still becomes on the own.
Yeah. My goodness, that's amazing.
Really? He picks up his own phone and like, you want to talk to him, he'll say, okay, come. He's got four full-time professions, but he behaves as if he has absolutely nothing to do.
Wow.
Yeah, and I thought, you know, that's amazing, because normally when you meet any celebrity, they're never giving you time. They you try and get a doctor's appointment, they behave like, you know, come after 3 months. Like,
right, true.
But he is like, okay, tomorrow, I'm not even ready with my questions.
And you were just a young girl, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I was 21.
Yeah, so, wow.
Well, I was quite amazed that. And so, therefore, if you look at his life, you know, he's 92. He's still going all over the world. He plays cricket.
Oh.
You see that? Yeah, he plays cricket. He goes jogging every day. You know, so it's very, if we live life correctly, then we can understand what he has always said, that aging is a myth.
Okay.
So you just live your life properly and you don't get anxious or tense. You don't know what the word stress means. You are never rushed or hurried. You have plenty of time for everybody, and you are running an academy full, you know, that's a full-time job for some people. He's an author, that's a full-time job for other people. He's a corporate guru, that's a full-time job.
Right.
Like, four full-time professions he has, and he behaves like he has nothing to do.
Wow.
Like, I mean, not that he has nothing to do, but when you talk to him, you never get the sense that he's rushed in any way or that he has no time for you. He has all the time in the world for you.
So he's with you completely. All the time. Wow.
Yeah. And all this is going on till 92. It's not like anything is reduced at 92. So there is a way to live life, a proper way of doing this. And if we knew that way, can you imagine humanity, all of us like that?
Yeah. Wow.
That'd be fantastic. That'd be like each one is just being the best he can be. We're not in competition with anybody else. But, you know, somebody, different people have different abilities, different skills, different levels of skills. Maybe, you know, every singer may not become Lata Mangeshkar. But every singer can be as good as they can be and be as happy as they can be. And as much growth as they can have. So this seems like something the whole world should know about.
Wow, it's quite, I'm still thinking about Swamiji, and I'll dive deeper into it. But before I get on to that next question, at any point of time, Janakiji, it's been 30 years now since that, you know, the fated phone call. Have you ever had a second thought at all?
I don't know what you mean by second thought. I've never had a second thought about Vedanta itself.
Yeah, that's right.
Had all the answers. I never doubted that.
Okay.
But yes, I have, you know, when I finished the course, I had these questions. Should I do this full time? Should I sort of go back? One part of me told me, no way, to leave this would be mad.
Oh.
And one part told me that maybe I should go experience the world in some way.
Right.
So I did go through all of that, and I not just once, but many times through the journey, I have had this thought that did I ever miss anything by sort of not going the normal way?
Correct.
But then from what I'm seeing, as the older I grow, I feel that it doesn't look like I missed much.
In the 20 minutes, I can tell you haven't missed anything.
So yes, of course, there's always going to be doubt. There's always going to be wonder, because that's our human condition. We keep wondering about things and all. But fundamentally, that the Upanishads and that Vedanta has something that is a huge contribution to my life and to the life of every human being, has just never been under debate. And once you start studying it, you say, my God, why don't people know this? Like, how much simpler their life would be.
Okay, back to Swamiji. You know, your journey with Swami Parthasarathiji, and it's been 3 decades now. Demystify the persona, the man.
Oh, I'm sure I can't do that. He basically leaves his students alone. He just says, I've given you the knowledge. So you go live whatever way you want. That's basically his thing. He's very, very detached as far as that is concerned.
Okay.
So if you go to him and ask for advice, he'll give it to you. But otherwise, he leaves you more or less alone. He says, don't come and hang around me. You go live whatever you want. And so naturally, nobody leaves him because he doesn't hang on to anybody. You know, he's the perfect parent, if you could say, because he lives the perfect life and he doesn't tell anybody to do it.
Wow.
Which is just the opposite of most parents who will make all sorts of funny, you know, things themselves and tell their children, oh, you must do this and you must do that.
Yeah.
He's just the opposite. He never call you and tell you. And of course, as institution head, like head of academy, there are rules that you have to follow and things like that. Even then, he gives a very, very long rope. But suppose you go well beyond acceptable limits. In rare cases, he just calls you and he says, leave now, this moment. Like you have to leave within the next half an hour, like that.
Yeah.
So he can be extremely strict. Even though he has given you a very, in fact, he gives you such a long rope because he thinks that growth has to be, growth always isn't freedom. Growth can never be in binding.
Yes.
Yeah. So he lets you have that freedom. But if you don't sort of, after multiple falls, you are not able to understand where you're going wrong and correct yourself, then you leave. That's it. And once he says leave, there's no court of appeal. There's nobody else you can go to. You just have to go.
Wow.
So he's this unusual mixture of total detachment and completely able to take whatever action needs to be taken with reference to the individual. He's not like passive.
Mm-hmm.
You can't take him for a ride.
Yeah. Got it.
So, because his intellect is always working, unlike ours, you know, we get involved and then we get all confused and then we don't know what to do and then we get fall into pity or something. None of that happens to him. As far as I know, I mean, there's no way any one of us can tell what goes on in his mind.
And he's always been like that.
Always full of fun and jokes and all of that as well. He'll sing songs, he'll imitate people, and you know, he can be very funny to be with also. He's a great mixture of huge depth and lightness. You know, he holds his himself lightly.
You said it so simply, but I'm just thinking he's so deep, right? So clearly being in control of oneself, I think, is the biggest quality one can have. And a lot of us don't have it. I'm sorry, not about you. At least I don't have it. So.
No, nobody has it the way he has it. His discipline is like, it's unbelievable. It's, you know, though it is a bit less, but right. For 60 years of his life, he was never in one place for more than 3 days.
Oh.
He spent most of his life in airplanes.
My goodness.
So he would, yeah, I mean, like, just travel. You know, all sorts of timings, all sorts of people, everything. Mm-hmm. But he did not slip up. On 4 o'clock, he gets up.
Ooh.
He writes his books, yeah. Then he does his yoga. Then he goes for a jog. Then he has his breakfast. He has his lunch every day at 1:15. And his dinner is not under his control because it's lecture and then people get out for lecture. So his sleep time is not under his control. But whatever is under his control is always the same thing.
My goodness.
Yeah, with that kind of travel, it is so difficult to maintain discipline. But he seems to do it. And you can see the result. He did it well. And, you know, you get what you deserve, right? So look at what he is at 92. I wonder what we will be at 92. And no lifestyle ailments, no diabetes or cholesterol or no lifestyle ailments.
Thank God.
Obviously, you know, he's eaten properly, he's done his exercise properly. For him, this is just normal. What's so big in that?
Yeah, he was looking at us and saying, yeah, what is the big deal, right?
Yeah.
Wow, awesome. Janki, you are a regular at a lot of prestigious universities and I know you keep giving talks and you come on panels and And one question to you, and you can choose whether you want to go deep into the answer or not, but how can students and, you know, young leaders be inspired to lean into, what should I say, the learnings from spirituality?
The first thing that that we should understand is that life, as it exists, it stretches out in front of us. So we must have some perception of what that is all about. And if we look around, we find that people aren't doing such a good job of it. Many people look upon poor people and think we should do some charity for them. They seem to think that only if you don't have money, you need help. That's not true, is it?
It's not true.
As if the rich don't require people to help them in their lives.
Right.
So once you see that, then and you ask this question, how can I ensure that my life goes well, that I actually reach my full potential, and I reach my potential being completely happy and satisfied within myself? If you can ask yourself this question, then your pursuit of that answer will lead you to the fact that the greater the unselfishness in an individual, the greater his mental equilibrium. So if you look at anybody who works for a higher cause in life, you will always find a peace on their face. You find that such people never ask for vacations. Like Swamiji has not taken a vacation in his whole life. Okay, but if we don't take a vacation, we'll actually collapse.
Correct.
Because why would we do that? Because our mind has got sort of heated up with our work. And if you don't take a vacation, we'll collapse. Some companies actually pay you to take the vacation because, you know, the stress will build up so much. So if we are able to work for a higher cause, with a higher vision, with a for something beyond merely my paycheck, beyond my big house and my big car and my fame and my name and, you know, beyond all this to something higher, greater, then I'll be able to be a very high performer in life. So you look at anybody who's done that, you'll see her. See Mother Teresa, what did she have after all? She just walked into a hellhole in Calcutta and took care of those people. And look at where, you know, like the whole world knows about her. What did Gandhi do? He left being a barrister. Barrister was the highest education of that time. To be from the inner temple or from the inns of court was like the it. And he threw it. Can you imagine what his parents might have said to him? He said, "Pagal ho gaye, okay, I sent you there to such a good education and you just threw it and now you're working like this." But that made him father of the nation. And not only made him father of the nation, he was very peaceful through the whole journey. Through its ups and downs, through the trials and tribulations, in his heart there was peace. Just as there was in Mother Teresa's heart, in the heart of anybody who's worked. If you look at somebody like JRD also, he builds up an airline.
Absolutely.
And he builds up everything. The government walks in and says, "I'm taking your airline away," and mess it up.
Yeah.
But he's able to take all this. Why? Because he works with the cause in mind. That's why Tata is where it is.
True. Very well.
Yeah. So as long as we are able to work for a higher cause, immediately our mind starts soothing. In fact, if you see the other way, it's very easy to see. Every time we have been agitated, we just stop and ask ourselves, why am I agitated? The answer is clear, isn't it? Things are not going the way I want.
I want. Correct. Correct.
If that I want wasn't there, there's no agitation.
Yeah, true.
So how do you remove the I want? By working for something higher.
Wow.
So when you ask the question, how can my life go well? How can I reach my potential and be happy at the same time? How can I be progressive and happy at the same time? Then you go hunting for some facts in life. And then you come to this fact. Then you get it once and for all.
Interesting. Very, very, truly deep. Something that I was guilty of till 10 years back, and a lot of us do, thinking spirituality is for the gray haired or when you reach 50. Can you dispel the myth for us?
Well, it's pretty obvious. If spirituality is meant to be a way of living life, you don't learn it at the end. You learn it at the beginning. So why would you do it at the end?
Yeah, that's a great answer. I'm just thinking, yeah. And maybe because we didn't know that spirituality is a way of living. That's a problem. That's the problem.
Yeah, we don't see it like that. We see it as something divorced from life, something, oh, good things, we must find time to do them. These are not good things that you find time to do. This is critical. It's like your oxygen. If you don't have this, nothing ain't working. It's just not going to work.
Yeah.
Relationships are not going to work. Work is not going to work.
Correct.
Parenting is not going to work. Health is not going to work. You have to know the way of doing this. You wouldn't run any equipment without reading the manual.
Yes.
Are you running your life without reading the manual?
Yeah, Swami Chinmayananda used to say this, right? So he would always say, yes, he used to say this.
You need the manual.
Yeah.
You can't say, oh, my machine is broken, now let me look at the manual. No, this is not the time.
You know, the next question is close to me, and I've been practicing it, but you're probably the most qualified to explain. Leadership and spirituality, Janakiji, please elaborate a little bit and explain the connection. More important in today's age and time.
The biggest, single biggest quality a leader requires is a higher vision in life.
Okay.
Because for a leader to work well, mm-hmm. he needs his people to follow him.
Correct.
If they don't follow him, his leadership, there's no leadership there.
Yeah.
He can, of course, issue diktats and they have to do follow his instructions, but that's not leadership. That's following diktats.
Mm-hmm.
Leadership is the capacity to create initiative amongst your people. Initiative is as opposed to incentives. When I tell my people, work, and then I will give you this much salary, and I will give you this, and I will give you that, you are incentivizing them, creating selfishness in them, and creating an inability to work.
Correct. Yeah.
Because after that incentive, that spurt from the incentive goes, then they're back to, you know, they don't even want this anymore. And you continue the incentive, it's no incentive to them. It becomes normal for them. So this is a no man's land. I mean, it's not getting us anywhere. It's a dead end street. So what we should be doing is learning to create initiative and initiative among people. That means they are following you. You are not doing anything. It comes only when you're yourself working for a vision higher than yourself. Even when the politician comes and asks for your vote, he doesn't say, make me prime minister.
Yeah.
He says, you know, he says, look, this is what we do for India, you know, or let's make America great again. But suppose he goes and he says, you know, I'd really like to be the president, so make me president. Nobody's voting for him. So the only way you get the people to be enthused by it is by having a higher ideal. You can fake it, but if you do it really, you'll get the full benefit.
Beautiful.
So the biggest quality of spirituality is the capacity to open our minds to something beyond ourselves, which is the primary quality of leadership. So okay. When I'm able to work beyond myself, or beyond me and my family, to something higher, nobler, greater. It could be the corporation, it could be the community, it could be the country, it could be humanity. Something bigger than yourself. And then people will follow. You see, Winston Churchill, for instance, he was the best PM during the war. Best PM for Britain, not for India, but for Britain, he was the best PM.
Right.
So what did he tell his people? He said, blood and sweat and toil and tears, you know, promised them. He said, you please give it to me.
Yeah.
What did John F. Kennedy say? Ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. So you see, every great leader has spurred on his people with a vision. And if he was himself true to that vision, he will be a great leader.
True.
If he himself was not true to that vision, then he will be a paper rose.
Yeah, true. Awesome. Very nice. Vedanta, if I were to ask you to explain it to a common man or somebody on the road or on the street, how would you explain it, Janakiji?
Vedanta literally means Veda Anta, end of knowledge. Veda means knowledge, yes, and Anta means end. So it means gaining the final knowledge of life, which means enlightenment. But on a more relative level, it talks about gaining clarity. Because when you have clarity, all other knowledge can come to you. So it is the end of knowledge in the sense, in the relative sense, as getting clarity. When you begin to see things for what they are, you are able to deal with them perfectly because you understand what's going on. So Vedanta is clarity. In other words, it is about developing our intellects. The stronger our intellect is, the better we can deal with life, deal with our mind, and deal with other people.
Interesting. Before I get to talking about your book, and I like the topic of your subject, the title of your book, but before I get to that, power of thoughts, and I know I've always believed thoughts are very, very powerful, but what are your thoughts on this?
There's a whole YouTube video that there is actually on our channel on the power of thought, yes. The power of thought is very simple in our life. Our whole life is our thought. There's nothing else here. People say there's destiny and there's luck and there's God and there's this and there's that. There's actually only your thought. Your life is exactly according to your thoughts. What you did, what you didn't do is according to your thoughts. What you felt or didn't feel is according to your thoughts. So your thoughts are the prime mover of life. Okay, we keep saying, oh, my life is like that because my destiny is like this and God did this and God did that. In Vedanta, the word for destiny is the same word for nature. Your nature is determining your destiny. So it is, the word is prarabdha. You know, your prarabdha means your nature and prarabdha means your destiny. So it's the same thing basically. And what is your nature but your thoughts? So your thoughts are the determiner of your life. So it's incredibly important that we analyze our own thoughts properly, because our thoughts determine our life, but we have two types of thoughts. Or Vedanta classifies them. They're not like two boxes or something, but Vedanta classifies them as two types, mana and buddhi. Manas, mind, and buddhi, intellect. So manas or mind, man in Hindi, is the irrational side of our personality, our likes and dislikes, our emotions, love, anger, greed, hate, jealousy, all of that is our mind. And then we have the intellect, which is our buddhi.
Correct.
So as long as we follow the buddhi thoughts, our life will go fine. But if we start doing without thinking, whatever our mind says, that's when our life starts going wrong. So let's say that you're a parent. It's your son's final exam. You walk into the house and he's watching television. When that was his time to study. So you go up in flames. So this mind of ours starts going up in flames. How dare you? You know how much I spent on your education. You're so irresponsible. You have no sense. You're watching television. This is the mind talking. So at that time, the filter of the intellect has to work. And ask ourselves this question. Whatever I'm about to say, is it going to give me the result I want? I want him to study, right? So what I'm about to say, is it going to do that? If according to me the answer is yes, then please go ahead. Go up in flames all you want. But if the answer is no, what are you doing it for? You're not getting what you want out of it, so why are you doing it? So when we don't apply our head, then all the problems start, all the frustrations start. Then we get so tired, we say, God did this to me, or destiny did this to me, or stars did this to me, or the placement of the door in my house did this to me. You must be joking.
There is an industry on it, mind you.
There is an industry on everything nowadays.
Brilliant. You know, so I'll come back to your book, and I'm just smiling at your answers, because I mean, we are talking about a very, probably the most complex of subjects on earth. It is Vedanta, philosophy, whatever you call it, spirituality is a very complex topic. And you are talking as if you're, you know, I'm thinking like I'm in kindergarten and my teacher is speaking to me, and you're speaking so beautifully. And I'm just amazed at the way you're demystifying. And I guess that's where you are, So I'm impressed, seriously. Your book, How Do You Know What You Know? Please tell us more. I'm intrigued by the title.
Yes, this is a basic epistemological question, that we are all so certain of so many things.
Yeah.
So why are we so certain about it? Have we ever thought? We're clear that this is it. But how do you know it is it? Have you examined it? Yeah. Never examined it, but you're so clear. How come? You say that, okay, if I kill all these innocent people, then I will go to heaven.
Right.
Okay, so how do you know that? So examine thoughts. Now, why examine thoughts? Because your life is your thought. So please examine them. Every wrong thought that you have had, you are paying for. You're paying for it with failure or with agitation or discomfort or whatever. Paying for it. So you have all this junk in the head. Please have a look at it. Yeah. All of it is not junk.
Yeah.
There's a mansion.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a beautiful mansion, but nobody's ever cleaned it. So there is lots of great stuff and there's lots of rubbish stuff. And if you don't throw the rubbish stuff out, the great stuff is never going to do anything great for you. It's never going to give you a pretty mansion because it's there, because all the rubbish is covering it. So I need to know for myself, what is the nonsense in my head? Throw it out. What is a wonderful thing? Keep it there. So that's what this book is about.
Brilliant.
So how do you decide which is the nonsense stuff and which is the stuff worth keeping?
And this book is available on Amazon and other books.
Yes. Kindle, Amazon, yes.
Okay. You speak to a lot of leaders, and this is the next two questions are very close to me as well. You speak to a lot of leaders and you know, different levels, middle management to senior management to CEOs. What is the one message you give them, Janaki? Irrespective of what they've called you for.
Yeah, the most important thing a human being can do in life is sharpen his intellect.
Wow.
So intellect must be understood. What is that intellect? It's not merely collection of information. It's not intelligence. We don't want to compete with Google.
Correct.
We can't. And we don't need to.
Yeah.
Our ability is in having an intellect. Intellect means our capacity to govern our own mind, our capacity to apply the knowledge we have. A computer can have a lot of intelligence. It can have a lot of information stored on its hard disk. Okay, let's say the computer has the entire information on firefighting on its hard disk.
Right.
It's got the whole plan there. But if a fire actually starts, the computer will perish in it.
So
this is what is becoming to us humans. We have all the knowledge in the world, but we don't seem to be able to use any of it. So we need an intellect to use the knowledge, to gain knowledge, to use it, and to control our mind.
It's a nice definition of intellect. I think people have misunderstood the definition of intellect, actually.
Yes, we are going around collecting information.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not going to help you unless you know how to digest that information.
Right.
It just causes, you know, sort of a mental diarrhea, as it were. You go on spouting that information out to the first person you see.
Yeah.
Out of context, usually.
You know, and now I want to take you to the other end of the spectrum, where Generation Y or the younger generation or the leaders, you know, they struggle with typical problems, like you have peer pressure, you have anxiety, and unlike the olden days, you have a lot of social media challenges. What's your advice to them? If you are suddenly asked to speak to 1,000 students, for example.
Depends on their age, of course, but the primary lesson that every human being needs to gain is please learn to use your head. Because if you don't learn to use your head, you could be the king, but you will be in the forest like Yudhishthira. That's the story of Yudhishthira, right? He was the king, but he spent his whole life in the forest. And had not Krishna been there, he would have died in the forest.
Yeah.
a good man, a God's good man, genuinely good man, but he doesn't operate on the intellect, so therefore he suffers. Krishna, on the other hand, also a genuinely good man, an enlightened soul, but operates on his intellect. That's why he can set everything right.
You actually gave the same answer for both the questions, and I'm just thinking, wow. So a generation Y and a leader needs to actually operate on their intellect.
Right. That's a human being, right?
Wow.
A being who operates on his intellect. The animals are supposed to operate on their minds, and that's fine for them.
Yeah.
Because they're programmed. Even though they're functioning on the mind, they're programmed to do things correctly. We have been given an intellect. So we've not been programmed. You know, you don't see a lion with long nails. He doesn't have to cut his nails.
Yeah.
You don't, yeah. You know, he doesn't have to worry about getting a haircut. Because everything in his life is fixed. In our life, it's not fixed. We've been given choice. And when you've been given choice, you've been given the intellect. So if you don't use your intellect for your choices, then you're worse than the animal, because the animal is protected by the fact that he's programmed. So, you know, animals are completely disciplined. Human beings can't be. They have to be trained.
Wow. Wow.
No, nowhere in the jungle you'll see a fat animal or a thin animal. You don't see them. They're just fine. They're doing fine. They go wrong, of course, when human influence comes, but by themselves, they're perfectly fine.
And this is so interesting you say this, because we did have the good fortune of spending some time in Zimbabwe and obviously going on one of those famed safaris. And yeah, so jungle has a life of its own. They have a law of their own. And the guide was telling us, he said, we don't interfere.
Yeah.
So he said, and then he explained the whole cycle to us. And I said, wow, so nature really... People call it God, people call it whatever. Somebody has clearly taken care of the whole thing.
Yeah.
Very
but
beautiful.
We are not taken care of. We are given the intellect to take care of ourselves. So better get that going.
True. 3 decades, and this question is specifically to you from a different angle. And the reason is you are very mature. You have elevated your thoughts and you know, the way you look at things, very different from a normal person, Janakiji. There is a lot that's happened, not only in the last 5-6 months of all of us across segments have been impacted. Even in the last 3 decades, there have been a lot of things that have not been so good on the economy, on us as individuals, on people, on communities. What gives you hope?
Because human beings have an intellect that gives hope. They were born with it, just as they were born with the ability to speak.
Okay.
Now, since we learned language, we can speak language. Right. And we didn't learn how to use our intellect, so our intellect is lying fallow, as it were.
Okay.
But there is Vedanta, there is the intellect. If we can get these two together, this planet will, I don't know where, we not the moon and Mars, but we could get anywhere. So we have the intellect, every human being has here's the knowledge of Vedanta, if people knew it. Or even if you don't know it, but you start thinking on your own, you still find the same truths. So either study Vedanta or think on your own. Either way, you will reach the same truth. All the great people thought on their own, right? If you read the works of, say, Wordsworth or something, you see Vedanta in it. You see, read Shakespeare, you see Vedanta in it. So then they got it, right? Nobody told them, yet they got it. So obviously we are all capable of getting it on our own. So let the situation get very bad and somebody is going to start thinking some more.
Right.
It's an unfortunate thing that we wait for the situation to get bad. We should actually prevent bad situations. But since we aren't doing that, situations will get very bad. And when they do get bad, people, you see, you have started asking, right? So people have started asking.
Yeah.
Now, so here's where we turn. As soon as people start asking, they start using their head a little and say, why? Why is this happening? What can we do about it? Even in this COVID times, some people have spent their time grumbling. Some people have used this time productively. Some people have gone further towards their goals. Some people have stagnated. So it's not so much a situation, but what you're making out of that situation. So once you start thinking, okay, this is very bad. Everything is very bad. Greed is overtaken. Business has become a bad word.
Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy to say business is a bad thing. All progress is happening because of business. And yet business is a bad word. I heard on television, there was a lady talking about how bad the health scene is. And her way of talking about it was saying, this is a so many billion dollar business and that is a so many billion dollar business. Like, isn't that good if it's so many billion dollars? I mean, that's giving people jobs and talking about it as if it's a bad thing.
Okay.
It's a great thing. But then why did it become bad? Because people have forgotten that the business was meant to serve people's needs.
And not
they thought business is meant for getting a higher and higher bottom line, even if everybody else dies because of it. Now, if you do that, then of course, like, look at how they pollute the waters, how they actually say they ran studies to show why cigarettes are good for you or why the colas are good for you. They had published studies showing that.
Really?
They do stuff like that, really.
Oh, I didn't
when you have the money, you buy whatever you want. So if you behave like this, then money becomes a bad word. But actually, money is a good word because if we had enough money, we'd feed all our people, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why is money a bad word or why is business a bad word? But now people are doing all this nonsense, so things are going to go bad worse, 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 worse until somebody says, what's happening? And then you start questioning. And then once that questioning starts and people start waking up a little bit, it has to come up. So the worse it gets, actually, the better it's going to get.
And I'm just tempted to tell you this. Can you influence our educational institutions to actually include Vedanta as a subject or a 1 hour session at least in a year? Can that be done?
In a year, well, I would say that just like the 3 hours, Vedanta has to be in there.
Yeah.
A student cannot come out of education without knowing it.
Absolutely.
So, well, I'd love to be part of the new education policy, but at the moment, it all seems to be going pretty slowly. Nothing seems to be happening there. So, but if we can get it in the right way, okay, not in the wrong way, divested of all dogmatic outgrowths. We're teaching people to think. We're not teaching people to believe, to follow, to be conditioned. That's not what we're teaching. We're teaching you to think. So if you can get that and communicate it, that'd be great.
Right.
But there is an issue there. Who is to teach this?
Come
so
back.
The people who teach have to have that character themselves. So how many of those are there?
Correct.
So there's a little problem here.
True. Very true. Very true. That's true. I'm sure you read a lot of books, Janakiji. And if I were to ask you, tough one, but if I were to ask you to name your favorite book, what would that be?
The most useful book?
Is that
your question?
Your favorite. No, your favorite book.
My favorite book. Whatever way you ask the question, my answer will have to be the same. It's going to be Vedanta Treatise because it has the entire knowledge of life.
Okay.
I mean, there are books I read, stupid books to take my mind off studies. I'm not about that. But if there was any one book that the whole planet should read, it would be Vedanta Treatise by A. Parthasarathy.
Okay. Wow, you actually answered two of my questions with one. and why do you say that, Kiji? Why do you say this?
Because it has the whole knowledge of Vedanta in a systematic way from the beginning to the end, starting with the assumption that you don't know anything.
Brilliant.
And then building up to the very end of Vedanta. The whole thing, systematically put, graded, from the easy stuff to the more difficult stuff. You don't start with karma and things like that, birth and death and all that. You don't start with. You start with basics of life and then you go. If you start with karma and reincarnation, definitely it all just goes into superstition and, you need to be trained to think to be able to understand such concepts without converting it into superstition. So it's graded and it's in contemporary language.
Oh.
And if you understand that book, you'll understand every religion.
Awesome. Awesome.
So if, before reading any religious text, Gita or Quran or Bible or Dhammapada or Gathas or any religious text, better have a look at that one so that, you know, you sort of put in the right thinking mold before you go there. And all the books say the same thing.
Yeah.
So if we can see it, but some people read different things in it.
So maybe the book should find its way into every library in school. I don't know. I mean,
yes, it should find its way into every home, and more than in every home, in everyone's head.
I don't know. Well, I guess we'll need to make some systemic changes. Interesting. I want to get into a little bit of a lighter thing here. The questions are not light, but kind of a rapid fire or a hot seat, if you may. So I'm going to ask.
Okay, I'll try.
All right. So. Vedanta is?
The knowledge of life.
Knowledge of life, okay. God is?
Your own self.
Adi Shankara. Happiness is?
Absence of desire.
Wow. I have to be reborn. Success is?
Achievement of objective.
Okay. Emotion is?
A modification of desire.
A modification of desire. Consciously.
Sorry?
No, you said modification of desire consciously is what you mean.
No, not consciously. When you want something and you get it, you get the emotion of happiness. If somebody interrupts that desire, then you get the emotion of anger. If you get what you want, then you want more, and that's greed. If somebody else gets what you want, then that's jealousy. So all these emotions are nothing but modification of desire.
Brilliant. This is awesome. Jankiji, let me confess now. I came for this talk fully prepared and a little nervous that, my God, I'm speaking to somebody who's very deep into a subject that, while I may claim to know, but it's obviously at a superficial level, enough to use it in my life and maybe make a difference. And here you have demystified and simplified the whole thing. And I'm saying, well, it's not so bad after all, you know. I just listed the basics here and there. But you've really been very, very, and clearly you are absolutely in the right profession. You've taken the right line. And Swamiji will be very proud of you, I'm sure, you know. So brilliant. You demystified the whole thing so beautifully. And I didn't find any answer of yours heavy at all. And I'm sure your lectures and your teaching, I even heard and you spoke the same. So the other day you had a conversation with Gurcharan Das and R. Gopalakrishnan and you spoke the same. And that was a very, very, that was obviously a different level. But then you spoke in a similar way in the other day. And I thought today is going to get heavy. So, but it's exactly the same. So that's brilliant. I want to thank you for coming to the studio and speaking to us, Jankiji. It's really a pleasure speaking to you. And I've learned a lot.
We have these online study classes of Vedanta, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
So maybe people can. So before you sign off, can you tell people where they can come to listen to or delve deeper into the knowledge or take a spoon of it and have it for themselves, please?
We have these Facebook pages on which these are live streamed. We also do it on Zoom. The Facebook pages are Vedanta Institute Mumbai and also How Do You Know What You Know?
Okay.
And it's live streamed, the classes, and they're also on Zoom. So people who want to ask questions and all that come on Zoom. Those who want to just listen,
awesome.
Listen on FB live streaming. It's also live streamed on YouTube channel Team Janki Santo and on our Instagram page, Dr. Janki Vedanta. And all these details is impossible to remember. So if you can remember my name, then you go www.janki.santok.com and all the details are there.
Awesome. Any last message for the listeners?
Swamiji always has said, learn two important things in life. Don't take anything for granted and question everything.
Thank you, Jankiji. On that note, thank you very much. It was really an elevated conversation with you.
Thank you so much.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.